announcements, let's turn to the person next to you, share your name if you don't know them, and give them a breakdown of your OOTD for today. And that stands for Outfit of the Day. You have 2 minutes. Ready, set, go. God, those who are in dating relationships or who are engaged, God, I pray that as they grow closer to one another, that they would be anchored in you and that they will also grow closer to you, God. I pray for this new season of premarital care, God. I pray that you would use these sessions to really bring the couples together and to give them wisdom and strength as they go forward. And Jesus, I also pray for Pastor Dan as he comes up here. I pray that you will speak the truth through him, that it will cling to our ears, and that you will engage us, and you will allow us to put what we learned today into practice. We love you, Lord, and in your name I pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Grace. Good afternoon. Are you there? Nice to see everybody today. Cold enough for you? I don't know if you had a chance to join us in the fellowship hall for a nice lunch where the furnace was not working over there, but I thought for a minute I was going to have to throw my sermon out and maybe bring some fire and brimstone instead, so just to warm us up. But I think it feels okay in here. I see a lot of coats, but it's better than over there, right? It's good to see everyone. We'll be in John 16 today. And I don't know if you recall some messages ago, I put up a picture of the whole book of the Gospel of John, kind of the picture of what's happening, what John's structure was, and kind of the top right was this quadrant where it was the first half of the last half of the book, and Jesus had this long monologue, and we are right in the middle of that long monologue, and in fact, The first verse of John 16 says, "All this I have told you so that you will not fall away." So everything he's been talking about after he washed their feet in chapter 13, he's talking through John 14, he's talking through John 15, 16, he's still going to be talking the whole chapter. 17, he'll be praying. So we're kind of right in the middle of this very, very long monologue of Jesus, and he reveals right here at least one of his motivations for why he's doing this, so that you will not fall away. And I wonder how that lands for you this morning. Is that a statement of judgment or a statement of mercy? How does your soul sort of unconsciously, subconsciously receive that word so that you will not fall away? I think it's possible to kind of receive it as both. Certainly in a church setting, you could perhaps imagine a parental figure or a pastoral figure or a person sitting in judgment over you saying something about not wanting you to fall away. And I just want to encourage you to consciously look and hear those words from Jesus as anything but sitting in judgment on you, but a statement of desire and wanting to not lose his disciples and hoping for their continued faithfulness because he's for them and knows all, knows so much more than they do. And so all these things that he is telling them, so you won't fall away. That would be the worst thing for you and for me. I don't want you to fall away. I want you. And so I just encourage you to receive that word in that spirit. And I've named today's sermon Heads Up, Disciples, because as I looked at the first 11 verses, there really just are three things about the future that Jesus is pointing out to them and sort of giving them a I used the term heads up. That's obviously a modern term. He is not using that term. I'm actually confused by that term because usually when people say heads up, what they mean is heads down. You know, like a baseball's flying in. Heads up! But don't they mean heads down? I'm not sure. It's a strange phrase to me. Jesus didn't use it. I'm using it. You know what I mean when I say heads up. Okay, here's something coming in the future heads up, I want you to be aware. And in that sense, I guess you're aware, your head is up and you're looking around. And they're going to be quite quick on the first two, and then we're going to spend more time spreading out the third one. Before we do, however, I'm going to put you into either pairs or triples, and nothing nearly so fun as OTD, right? Outfit of the day. I'm wearing a new Christmas sweater I got for my wife, in case you wanted to know. I would like us to talk about, I brought up the word judgment, and I would like to add two words to that, righteousness and sin, three basic words in Christianity, and I'd just like you to take a couple minutes in pairs or triples or four or whatever, and just kind of get a agreed upon definition of those words and what we mean by them or what you mean by them. Ready, set, go. Okay. Excellent work. Nicely done. We will come back to those in a bit. But first, heads up number one. Jesus says to the disciples, persecution is coming from within your own faith community. And I'll read verses 2 through the first half of verse 4, what he says exactly. They will put you out of the synagogue. In fact, the time is coming when anyone who kills you will think they are offering a service to God. They will do such things because they have not known the Father or me. I have told you this so that when their time comes, you will remember that I warned you about them. Imagine that, killing somebody and actually believing God is pleased with this. I think immediately of Saul, right? He lived that out and thought he was doing God's work by killing the actual closest, most brought inside and taught disciples of that same God. It's coming, Jesus says, and he's giving them a heads up. I've told you this so that when it happens, you'll remember. I said this was going to happen. What I noticed, though, in this section, though, was two sort of graces. Not Grace Kim, not Grace Shin, not any other real human graces that attend this church, but grace as far as maybe I could have written the word gospel or good news or silver lining or in the midst of something so terrible, listen to these other two things. The first one was, they don't know God. They don't know Jesus. This is the reason they're acting like this. And Jesus himself would go on to face the cross the very next day after this monologue and pray in Luke chapter 23, verses 33 and 34. And when they came to the place that is called the skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." And I just see that as a piece of grace in the fact that if Jesus can forgive people killing him, even if we face persecution, there is grace and comfort in realizing this human being does not get it. They don't understand. They don't know what they're doing in some respect and are still worthy of asking God to forgive them. The second grace was simply, if their time is coming, like it says in verse 4, it seems to me necessarily that their time will end. Right? Verse 4 said, their time is coming for this persecution. That means we're placing this on the continuum of time, and it won't last forever. It's not the final word. The good news is their time will be of a specific and short duration. All right, heads up number 2. I'm going away. I'm going away. Verses 4b through 7 read like this. I did not tell you this from the beginning because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me. None of you asks me, where are you going? Rather, you are filled with grief because I have said these things. But very truly I tell you, it is for you, for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And I saw the same kind of pattern here. Bad news, the disciples are grieving. They don't want Jesus to leave. This is their rabbi, their teacher, their all. They've given up their lives to follow this man. He's changed them for 3 years. It's been their life to walk with him. I'm going away is not good news to them. And yet, here's two pieces of good news. Number one, Jesus said, it's for your good. They may not feel that. They may not get that. They may not understand that. But he's telling them, no, really, it's better. It's better that I leave for you. And secondly, the name he gives the Holy Spirit, the Advocate. Seriously, I can see a movie. I don't know if it would be in the MCU or some other world or some universe, but the Advocate is the hero, right? How can you not be excited about someone being named the Advocate? That entire name is centered around, wow, he's going to do something for me, for us. He's got power to advocate for others with the powers that be. Jesus names the Holy Spirit the Advocate. He comes and his very role, his very job is to advocate for us, for the Father's will, for Jesus' kingdom on earth. That's the name of the Holy Spirit. What a great name. He's also called the Comforter in other places. And so we come to heads up number 3. Here's what the Advocate is going to do. He's going to prove the world to be wrong about 3 things. And indeed, verse 8 says, when he comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. The 3 words that you just discussed a minute ago. So before we look at those 3 words in more detail, I have 3 short, simple questions to ask about this third point. And those questions simply are, whom, how, and what? When I first wrote these up, it was who, how, and what. And I really wish it could have stayed that way, because whom is so kind of pretentious and annoying. But as a former high school English teacher, I just could not let it go. It is in the objective case, and so it needs to be whom. But I bet before your children or grandchildren are in school, maybe we'll have dropped that in the English language. But for now, it's still here, and so we got to go with the whom when we're in the objective. But it bothered me even. Number one, whom? My question is, if you were here the last time I spoke, which I can't remember if it was Christmas Eve or New Year's Eve, whom have we learned in John 15, Jesus' use of the term the world can include sometimes? Do you recall the passage where Jesus was warning the disciples about the world hating them? And then who does he immediately move into talking about? Was it the outside Gentile, non-Jewish, non-religious Roman world? It wasn't. It was their own religious leaders. Surprising, shocking. Didn't seem like that was who the world was. And so I just want to remind us, whom have we learned Jesus' use of the world can include? Certainly outside, but we don't dare forget that sometimes we are influenced to also act like the world, and even in Christ, behave in the world's way, or use the world's logic, or the world's ideas of what strength is. And what this does for me in answering this whom question with us, the answer is us, can include sometimes. I need to be aware, I need to be humble, I need to be careful, I need to not move into a posture of judgment only towards others, but to remember that I too might slide into wrong ways of thinking about these three words that we're about to talk about. That's the posture, I believe, that asking that whom question has done. It increases our humility. Second question is how? How do you think the Holy Spirit will do this? How do you imagine the Holy Spirit convicting the world or proving to the world or whichever word you want to use? The ESV says convict the world concerning sin, righteousness, and judgment. How does the Holy Spirit do that? Or let me ask it this way. When you talk about the Holy Spirit speaking, do you normally think of that and speak of that in terms of him talking to those outside of Christ? Or do you more normally think about it and talk about it in terms of the Holy Spirit talking to those he inhabits, those who are the temple of the Holy Spirit? It's the latter, right? That's more normative for us. And I'm not here to say that God can't speak to anybody he wants. He absolutely can. But what this question does for us is it gets us to realize, number one, just how unusual that idea is for us in thinking of the Holy Spirit speaking to the world and the outside. And in order to picture it, I think we have to realize, again, the answer to this question is us. Like, we're going to be involved in this. We're going to be part of how the Holy Spirit convicts the world and speaks to the world. It's going to involve the church. It's going to be part of his convicting them that they're wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment as they're bumping up against God's people. And so I put the answer to how and to whom as they involve us. And so finally, the third question, what? And you can see I'm out of room on my slide, and so I have no choice but to kind of bump whom and how up to the left and expand my three questions, which are part of my third point, into three more points. It's kind of like one of those Russian dolls. You just keep opening up more and more points. And so what are we to make of these three reasons? So in talking about these three things, that the Holy Spirit is convicting of, I want to ask the question, what are we to make of these three reasons? Listen to verse 8 through 11. When he, also called the Holy Spirit, also called the Advocate, comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. What did you think of those explanations? Was there any overlap in anything Jesus just said with anything you said in your group? Is there any illumination that is immediately apparent by these three answers and our thinking about sin, righteousness, judgment? How much automatic sense did they make for you? I am courageous enough to boldly say something similar to what I just heard. Was that zero I heard? Oh, thank you. I knew it was you. I just couldn't find you. These are not expected explanations. Stopping and actually listening to what Jesus is saying might make you say, I'm not sure how those relate or how those prove the world to be wrong about anything. So I just want to encourage you, you are not alone if that is your first kind of reaction. However, I want to understand what Jesus is getting at, and I believe he is not trying purposely to not be clear. I just think this is an opportunity for us to have a window onto the divine perspective of what is actually important to point out. And the reason I cannot is a flaw in my own presuppositional thinking. It isn't that we cannot see how these things are related. I just think this is one of those passages where we're going to have to spend a little time working at it and asking, why did he say it like this? How do these explanations demonstrate, yeah, the world is wrong in how they think about sin, how they think about righteousness, how they think about judgment, because these three things. I think we would have been more comfortable if it had been something like, and I'm going to just try and make this up off the top of my head, the world is wrong about sin because they don't realize how serious it is. The world is wrong about righteousness because they just don't get it, that their righteousness is like filthy rags. And they're wrong about judgment because they just don't realize it's coming. That sounds kind of more familiar to me. Jesus didn't say anything like that. Why? So my answer to my what question is not an answer, it's another question. I wonder, can we get some good biblical thinking percolating by working backwards from how we imagine that the world does view sin and righteousness and judgment? And that's really my only goal in this. We're not going to move through this last third point, and I'm going to tell you, boom, there's the answers. My goal is to, how do we get some good biblical thinking percolating by wrestling with what Jesus actually says? All right, ready? Point three in my third point of point three up above. Here we go. Sin. The world defines sin like what? Crossing a line. Like, I did wrong. I displeased, maybe they would say God, maybe they would say some other deity, maybe they would say the Bible, maybe they would say some other book. But there's this common understanding that everybody has. Okay, there's a barrier, and sin is crossing that, being naughty. I think everybody agrees with that. Where we're different in the church from the world, as defined as like not the church, would probably be in how much we care about that, right? Since we care about crossing that line, we would say things like, you know, we missed the mark because we want to hit the mark, or, you know, I keep failing, or I'm a wretch, or things that hint that, yes, the line was crossed, but that's bad, and I don't want that. And the world might have the opposite effect. There might be kind of like a celebration of, ooh, we're crossing the line and we like it. And there might be a encouragement. Okay, you need to live a little. Sin is going to do you some good. We even have a city in our country called Sin City. And I promise it's not named that to warn people and keep them away. It's a marketing ploy to draw people to come spend their money because it's the best city we have. So, I don't want to focus on how we are different, per se, in viewing sin from the world. I want to go back to sort of that shared definition of transgression of a line. And I want to ask, does Christ's critique of that shared definition, does Christ's reason for why the world is wrong about sin critique that shared definition? Let me re-say that since I said it unclearly. Does Christ's reason for why the world is wrong about sin, because they don't believe in me, critique our view of what sin is? And by critique, I don't mean jettison. I am sure that most of what you said about sin was stuff I would have said about sin. But Jesus' words still seemed perplexing. What does he mean, because people do not believe in me? The Holy Spirit will prove people to be in the wrong about sin because, he didn't say because they don't care about committing it, because they think it's fun, because they're not behaving. No, because people do not believe in me. How does that inform my view of what sin is? When I find sin in my life, does that color what I think is going on? I'm not lusting just because I'm a wretch. I'm lusting because I don't really trust him. I'm easily angry, not just because I can't get it together, but I don't really believe in him. I don't think his way is really going to work. I don't trust him. I need more control. I've idolized money in my life because, well, that feels way safer than any kind of life where you're actually praying every day for your daily bread. No, I didn't go to school for that. I'm going to be safe and comfortable. Name your sin. Whatever sin besets you. If you take it all the way to the very bottom, I think you'll see it's a matter of not believing, not trusting, thinking this will be better. I can't trust God that much. I can't take him that seriously. Maybe a little sin will be okay. The world, bigger world now, including all of us, is wrong about sin. The Holy Spirit is here to prove that to them. And the reason is because people do not believe in me, Jesus says. Number two, righteousness. What did you say in your group? I would have talked about, if I had, you know, been thinking about how I've most of my life thought about righteousness, it's pretty much just the flip side of sinning, right? Righteousness is, well, I sin a whole lot less. I'm a really good guy. I acted really holy. I had a, and this is understandable, a very individualized view of righteousness. It was basically, I thought about, you know, my behavior. Oh, God is righteous. Well, I'm going to be righteous. I'm going to do everything right. The Hebrew word tzedakah is much more social. It involves relationships with other people. It involves looking to the marginalized. It really draws in the Hebrew word for justice, mishpat, and always marries those two things together. Righteousness and justice in the Old Testament go hand in hand, and I grew up with very little understanding of that aspect of righteousness. I think the world much more thinks about righteousness in terms of, oh, have you seen this guy? He's a serious Christian. That guy's a righteous dude. We call attention to good works. We notice our own good works. We do well and we think God is really noticing. He is impressed with my behavior lately, and he probably owes me. I've got some good things coming my way because of my righteousness. Or we make lists of what righteousness requires. It's easy to look back and see how this characterized Pharisees in Jesus' day, but church religious culture is full of lists of what's required, especially if you aspire to be on a serve team or the welcoming team specifically or the worship team or things like that. You will notice people suddenly have a higher standard for you. You know, your righteousness better... You better shine that up, buddy. You're on a serve team. Let's get righteous here. Not all bad, but that kind of attitude I just had is not very Jesus-like, and nor does Jesus say anything that seems to be anything that I would have said. You're wrong about righteousness, world, because... And Jesus says, because I am going to the Father, where you can see me no longer. That cleared it all up for you, right? No more perplexing thoughts after that. Sure, I know what he means. I don't. I did a lot of reading here. I did a lot of looking at commentaries. And basically what I'm going to try to do for you is sort of just summarize a vanilla version of what was said. And that's the best I can do. And I think there's some value in that sometimes, and I think it's very true. Basically, this shift of looking at where Jesus is going, the ascension, places the source and the authority and the ultimate ability to define and determine and demonstrate and live and where God is the end-all and the be-all of where righteousness comes from. We don't get to do it. We don't have control. We don't control other people. Jesus is actually saying, where you can see me no longer, it's important that I'm leaving, and you're wrong about righteousness, world, because I'm flying out of here, and I'm going to be back where perfect righteousness is. It's defined in Jesus, the person. And the more that we write the script, make the rules, control others, judge ourselves, judge others, trust our good works, become self-righteous, all of these ways that righteousness gets contaminated, Jesus is calling us to focus on Christ and focus where he is going, back to the Father. And that is the source of righteousness. I think his statement here just, it drives me back to the scriptures. I think there's more to learn, there's more to see, there's more to understand, because we do want to be righteous, but we want to do it in God's way. And if Jesus says it's important to point out that he's going back to the Father, well, I'm going to take him. I want to take him at his word, and it drives me to study more. I don't want to lose the source of righteousness, because far too often in my life has my righteousness been self-righteousness, which is a pile of filthy rags. That's the best I can do on that one. Let's go to judgment. This one's a little easier, right? I talked about smiting in a sermon recently, kind of the world's view of God as a smiter, quoted some different movies and people's experiences of daring God to smite them. I was reminded of a cartoon this week from my maybe favorite cartoonist, Gary Larson, retired artist of the Far Side, if we could put that up there. This idea that, you know, there's a piano hanging over your head and all God has to do is press the smite key and boom, it's coming down on you. That's judgment. That's how the world sees judgment. God's just waiting. Just tick him off one more time and oh, I hope you get it. It's just an easy way for the world to think about judgment and about God. And especially as we bump up into the problem of suffering and a good God and all of the suffering our world has. But the world is wrong about judgment. The Holy Spirit is going to prove to the world to be in the wrong about judgment. Why? Because the prince of this world now stands condemned. Is that another slam dunk for you? Oh, yeah. Good one, Jesus. That clears it up for me. Not again. Again, this is just such a different perspective. And it's Jesus versus Dan's perspective. I'm going to jettison mine and turn to what does he mean? Why is this such a good explanation for why the world is wrong about judgment, about viewing God like that? What does he mean? It's not this you're toast, I'm toast, he's toast idea. It's a totally different picture. I just have to drop that and sit and look at those words, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. Well, I see a couple things. I see he's talking about something that's already accomplished. He's telling me it's important for you to note you're wrong about judgment because something was already done. And what was done really didn't have anything to do with any human beings. It had to do with a spiritual being. So this took place in another realm, a spiritual realm, and the prince of this world, we all know who he's talking about, he was judged. He was condemned. He stands condemned. In other words, at this point in history, it actually wasn't going to happen until the next day, but Jesus is still able to speak of it, and it's already been done. The prince of this world now stands condemned. There has been a shift. Judgment has come upon the one in need of judgment, and that is everything, and that's why you're wrong about how you think about judgment. We would have been so much less surprised if this verse read something like, prove to the world to be in the wrong about judgment because it's really on the way. But he didn't. Jesus, even at the end of time, when he comes on the clouds and his robe is bloody and he has a sword, it isn't the laying flat of the unrepentant that happens next in that passage, like I was taught. Jesus came the first time, he was nice. He's coming the second time, oh, not going to be nice. The actual picture painted in Revelation is not that. That blood on his robe is his own. That sword is just coming out of his mouth. It's his words. And there aren't any people killed in that particular passage, in that particular battle. I was cheated in that Mark Driscoll sort of explanation of what the end of the world was meaning. And I didn't understand the lamb that was slain. Doesn't view judgment or talk about judgment or bring judgment in the same ways that I sometimes assume. Now, that doesn't mean judgment isn't a thing. It is. It is a thing. The world is going to end. It's going to come. Man, death comes once to a man or a woman, and then comes the judgment. So it is a concept, a biblical concept, and God is just, and God will judge. But how does my human shortcoming of understanding of judgment need to be critiqued by Jesus saying, here's what really proves you're wrong in some of the ways you think? The world is different now. You can live in victory because this happened. I keep pointing at that screen. I'm sorry, that's the one I'm reading. The prince of this world now stands condemned. That must color how you view judgment and what you think judgment is and who you think judgment deserves judgment and deserves to sit in judgment. It isn't you. My simple closing question on this last thing is, how do Jesus' words challenge and critique and get us to reevaluate? In what ways have I adopted the world's view of sin and righteousness and judgment? And are there things I don't understand biblically? And God knows we all want Jesus' words to challenge us in places that we may be wrong. Because those words are real words, and they mean real things. So here's my conclusion. The worship team may come, because this will be very brief. In our hopes to have the advocate continue to grow us up and to use scripture for its stated purpose, a double-edged sword in my soul, dividing, changing, transforming me, growing me to be more like Jesus. So his words are not perplexing, but, oh, I see what he means. I close with these three prayers. You can close your eyes if you want to. You can keep your eyes on me while I read them. Both are fine. But there are three prayers related to these three things. May I believe in Christ so deeply that my view of sin becomes more and more biblical. May I have such a vision of the ascended Christ that my view of righteousness is always and ever grounded in his above. May the reality of the judgment of the prince of this world be so real within my imagination that I experience Christ's freedom and victory. And these are the three things we pray, Lord Jesus, from these 11 verses in your talk with your disciples. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the challenge that it brings to our minds and our souls. We truly do want to be people of the book. And have you transform us to be more like you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Or praying as you would want to, or feel free.
recognize the privilege it is to follow a God who would tell you things so that you will not fall away? Every human soul longs to belong. God says, you belong. I am telling you these things so that you will not fall away. Be blessed in Jesus' name.